Luke 13, verse 19 through 20. And then Jesus asked, "What is the kingdom of God like? What shall I compare it to? It is like a mustard seed, which a man took and planted in his garden. It grew and became a tree, and the birds of the air perched in its branches." Again, he asked, "What shall I compare the kingdom of God to? It is like yeast that a woman took and mixed with a large amount of flour, and it worked all the way through the dough." And then in Matthew 17:14-21. When they came to the crowd, a man approached Jesus and knelt before him. "Lord, have mercy on my son," he said. "He has seizures and is suffering greatly. He often falls into the fire or into the water. I brought him to your disciples, but they could not heal him." "Oh, unbelieving and perverse generation," Jesus replied. "How long shall I stay with you? How long shall I put up with you? Bring the boy here to me." Jesus rebuked the demon, and it came out of the boy, and he was healed from that moment. Then the disciples came to Jesus in private and asked, "Why couldn't we drive it out?" He replied, "Because you have so little faith. I tell you the truth. If you have faith as small as a mustard seed, you can say to this mountain, 'Move from here to there,' and it will move. Nothing will be impossible for you." That's the reading of God's word. I have 10 classified ads from True Classified Ads in daily papers. Number 10. Wanted: man to care for cow that does not smoke or drink. 9. Try us once, you'll never go anywhere again. 8. Dog for sale. Eats anything and is fond of children. 7. Illiterate: write today for free help. 6. Stock up and save, limit 1. 5. Man wanted to work in dynamite factory, must be willing to travel. 4. Semi-annual after Christmas sales. 3. For sale, antique desk. Suitable for lady with thick legs and large drawers. 2. We do not tear your clothing with machinery. We do it carefully by hand. And number 1. Used cars. Why go anywhere else to be cheated? Come here first. Most of these classified ads are funny, because someone left out a word, or misspelled a word, or a phrase. Sometimes it's the things you don't notice, the little things, that have the greatest value. In the scripture today, Jesus tells a parable using one of the smallest seeds known to the people of that day, the mustard seed. How many have ever seen a mustard seed? It's not much bigger than a speck of dust, and yet Jesus uses this small, seemingly insignificant seed to tell us about his kingdom, the church. I have 2 bags up here, identical. Or are they? Can anyone see the difference between the 2 bags? This one has a mustard seed in it. This one does not. And as you leave this morning, there are bags and on the table in the middle of the narthex, each one of you can take that has one mustard seed in it. Trying to remember. Parables were stories that Jesus told, where he used common items that people often saw every day to describe spiritual truths and realities they'd never seen or would never see. No one had ever seen the kingdom of God Jesus was describing. So he told his parables this to help them visualize what it was going to be like. But why you use an item like a mustard seed? It was small, insignificant, relatively unimportant seed. It wasn't highly priced. It was useful for flavoring food. Its leaves were edible, and some believed if prepared properly, parts of the plant had medicinal properties. But it was also something of a nuisance plant. Jesus calls it a tree, but it's actually more of a shrub. It grew sometimes to the height of 10 or 12 feet, and its stem would become as thick as a man's arm. But it was still a shrub. It wasn't an overly attractive plant. And in fact, at times, people regarded it as a weed. We don't dare plant it in our gardens. It would crowd out all the other plants and literally take over. The mustard plant was a common, ordinary shrub that had things about it that people liked and things about it people didn't like. So why choose the mustard seed to represent the kingdom? Why choose something so common, so ordinary, to paint a picture of the powerful and majestic kingdom? In the majestic kingdom, Jesus would soon invest so much to create. It just doesn't make any sense. Or does it? I believe Jesus chose the mustard seed in part because it was so small, so insignificant. Listen to what the scriptures say in 1 Corinthians 1, 18 through 29. For the message of the cross is foolishness to those who are perishing, but to us who are being saved, it is the power of God. For it is written, I will destroy the wisdom of the wise, the intelligence of the intelligent, I will frustrate. Where is the wise man? Where is the scholar? Where is the philosopher of this age? Has not God made foolish the wisdom of the world? For since in the wisdom of God, the world through its wisdom did not know him, God was pleased with the foolishness of what was preached to save those who believe. Jews demanded miraculous signs, and Greeks looked for wisdom. But we preach Christ crucified, a stumbling block to Jews and foolishness to Gentiles. But to those whom God has called, both Jews and Greeks, Christ, the power of God and the wisdom of God. For the foolishness of God is wiser than man's wisdom, and the weakness of God is stronger than man's strength. Brothers, think of what you were when you were called. Not many of you were wise by human standards. Not many were influential. Not many were of noble birth, but God chose the foolish things of the world to shame the wise. God chose the weak things of the world to shame the strong. He chose the lowly things of the lowly things of this world and the despised things and the things that are not to nullify the things that are. And so that no one may boast before him. Why did Jesus choose the mustard seed to represent his kingdom? Because God is always consistent. He chose the foolish things of the world to shame the wise. God chose the weak things of the world to shame the strong. He chose the lowly things of this world and the despised things and the things that are not to nullify the things that are, so that no one may boast before him. I have heard of churches that become the in place to be. All the pretty people want to go there. All the influential gather at the doors. Politicians and businessmen go to that building because that's where everybody else is. Those churches could be described as a mighty oak because of its influence and power in the community. They often run into the danger of being the place where people go to see each other, but not to see Jesus. Jesus did not want his church to be a mighty oak. He wanted it to be a humble mustard shrub. He doesn't want people to go to church and be impressed on how important they are and how valuable the people around them are. He wants people to bow in modesty before his throne. In short, he doesn't want people to get excited about themselves. He wants them to get excited about what he can do through them, what he can do in their lives, the changes and the healing he can bring to them. Jesus chose the mustard seed for his parable because of its size. He used it because even something as small as a mustard seed had miraculous power within it. Think about it. A seed, not much bigger than a pinhead, had within it the power to become a towering plant. If you've done much work in a garden, you've grown used to the idea of being able to put a seed in the ground and watch its plant grow from the ground. In fact, you might not have even given it much thought. But let's say next week, Bill Gates gathers all the world's most brilliant scientists together and tells them, "I'll give you all the money you could possibly want if you make something for me. I want you to create an item the size of a pinhead that I can bury in my backyard out in the sun. And I want this item to grow out of the ground and become a living, life-giving plant." Will he be able to do it? Will his brilliant scientists, having untold billions of dollars at their disposal, be able to take inanimate material and produce something as simple as a garden variety seed? Of course not. Bill Gates is perhaps the richest man in the world, and he is a certified genius who has done things no one ever thought possible. But I'm here to tell you, I don't care how smart he is or how much money he has, he's not smart nor rich enough to create anything as amazing as a little seed. There's no scientist alive that can duplicate that kind of miracle. Likewise, the kingdom of God, the church, has the power to do things that no human institution can emulate. Paul wrote in 1 Corinthians 3:11, "No one can lay any foundation other than the one already laid, which is Jesus Christ." In other words, you cannot duplicate what God intends to do in his church. God's power in the church has a life within it that defies understanding, and it all starts with a small seed inside the heart of an individual. And once that seed takes root and begins to grow, that which was lifeless and empty becomes filled with the power of God. Jesus chose the mustard seed because of the humility it represented, and because of the life-giving power it had within it. And then Jesus chose a mustard plant to represent his church, because the mustard seed has to die in order to give life. Paul wrote, "But someone may ask, how are the dead raised? What kind of body will they come from?" How foolish! What you sow does not come to life unless it dies. When you sow, you do not plant the body that it will be, but just a seed, perhaps of wheat or something else. But God gives it a body he has determined, and to each kind of seed he gives its own body. In other words, a seed has to die to bring life. Was it possible Jesus was saying that same, in order for the kingdom to come to life? Something had to die. At least two or three times in his ministry, Jesus told his disciples, "The Son of Man must suffer many things and be rejected by the elders, chief priests, and teachers of the law, and he must be killed, and on the third day, raised to life." In fact, Paul tells us that this is the message of the gospel. By this gospel, you are saved, that Christ died for our sins according to the scriptures, that he was buried, and that he was raised on the third day, according to the scriptures. In other words, Jesus had to die and be buried in order to give life to his church and to us. It's amazing how a tiny mustard seed could say so much about Christ's kingdom. As I studied for this sermon, I had to admit that it was quite a bit for me to comprehend. The idea of using a small seed, a little larger than a speck of dust, being used to describe the power and the mystery of what Jesus did to create his kingdom. Was there that much power in a tiny seed that Jesus would want to use something so small to represent something so majestic? I think the answer is yes. I don't think there's anything on earth that has the ability to bury the power that lies within one tiny seed. In a cemetery in Hanover, Germany, is a grave on where there were placed huge slabs of granite and marble cemented together and fastened with heavy steel clamps. It belongs to a woman who did not believe in the resurrection of the dead. Yet strangely, she directed in her will that her grave be made secure so that if there were a resurrection, it would not reach her. On the marker were inscribed these words, "This burial place must never be opened." In time, a seed that had been covered by the stones began to grow. Slowly, it pushed its way through the soil and out from beneath them. As the trunk enlarged, the great slabs were gradually shifted so that the steel clamps were wrenched from their sockets. A tiny seed had become a tree that had pushed away.